I'd love thee, I'd know thy heart mine. For thee all the faults of sin I resign. My gracious Redeemer, a Savior, ever I love thee, my Jesus did die. I love thee because thou hast first loved me, and purchased my heart.
I'll see you with the glare. Good
morning and welcome. This is Castle Hill Seventh-day Adventist Church, and we love having you worship with us. It's that time of the year where the holidays have come to an end and the schools go back. And for some, it's good news. For some, well, it's not such good news. I know I love the holidays. There's no one rushing me to get up in the morning, get anyone ready for school. The roads are usually clearer. However, to be honest, with COVID over the past year, changes haven't been so dramatic, and being stuck at home, well, you don't see as much of that. But I'd like to remember and take the time out to remember those who are starting school for the first time. And that's going to be a big occasion for those who are starting either kindy or year one or whatever it is that you're starting. It's going to be an exciting time. It's going to be a sad time for some parents who find it hard to let go of their children, whereas some just off you go, have a good time. And also for those who are starting a new school, maybe it's you've moved to a new location, you've got to start a new school, or maybe you're just joining a new campus. Whatever, as a church, we would like to wish you all the best for the coming year. I'd also like to send out a big thank you to our teachers who will be guiding our young people through 2021. I wish you God's wisdom, patience, and inspiration as you craft your programs for 2021. I'd also like to welcome back our senior pastor, Pablo, back from leave. We're so blessed to have him as a senior pastor, and I look forward to his leadership through this coming year, and also to hear his timely message for today. Now, for those of you who made New Year's resolutions and have already broken them, our message today is aptly titled, The Choices We Make. So wishing you all a blessed day, and have a happy Sabbath.
Good morning. Would everyone bow their head for prayer, please? Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for a new year. You knew what happened last year. You knew that COVID was coming, and you know how it's all going to pan out this year. But Lord, we know that you have us. You've got our back, Lord, and we trust in you. Lord, we love our church family here, and we put our church, our children, our families, our friends, and our lives in your hands, Lord. Lord, today Pastor Pablo is going to talk about the choices we make. Lord, we have to make choices every day, and help us to choose you. Help us to be purposeful about it. Help us to be deliberate, Lord. Lord, help us to give our will to you and just come into our hearts and transform us and fill us with the Holy Spirit. We can't live for you, Lord, without you changing us. And we want to put you first in our lives, Lord, but we desperately need you to do that for us. So, dear Lord, be with us now. Protect our families, protect our loved ones, protect our friends, protect our greater community. Help our church shine this year. And now, please, as we listen to the sermon, settle our minds, settle our hearts, and Lord, help us to be changed. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
Time to worship. Come.
walking around these walls. I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won, for you have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands, great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands, this is my confidence, you've never failed me yet. I know the night won't last, your word will come to pass, my heart will sing your praise again. Jesus, you're still enough, keep me within your love, my heart will sing your praise again. Your promise still stands, great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. Still in your hands, this is my confidence, you've never failed. Your promise still stands, great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands, this is my confidence, you've never failed.
My confidence, you've never failed me.
So I was reading through a devotional last year, and it raised a concept that I'd never actually thought of before. The author Timothy Keller said that God was a defender of the poor. And that's one of the main things that he was concerned with this earth. Now, today, it seems very normal. But back in the day, it was a revolutionary idea. And the concept in those days was that the gods identified with the elites of the or the upper classes. They believed because they were the most virtuous, they were divinely blessed with power and wealth. But God so often made that focus on taking care of the fatherless and the widows and those that needed support. And as a church, that's something we strive to do. Not everybody can do everything for everyone, but one thing we can do is support these efforts with our tithes and our offerings. So right now we have an opportunity to give. So if you want to head over to eGiving and support the many projects we have as a church, it's very easy to use, and we would appreciate that as we, as a church, through 2021, reach out and support those who in our community have greatest needs. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for blessing us. We are in the corner of the globe that is amongst the most blessed of all. And we return some of what you have given to us. And I pray that you use it to help those who you champion, the fatherless, the widows, those that need support. And help us as a church to be generous in our giving is my prayer. Amen.
Today, Indy blows into a stick. Samuel does some tricep dips. And a legend makes a return.
All my troubles seem so far away. Now it looks like a
But first, we're going to talk about something very important. We're going to talk about engines. Now what you have here is a 1984 Ferrari Mondiale Quattro Valvole. This is a very special car to me. However, it is at this time the only Ferrari that hasn't gone up in value. That doesn't mean that it's a bad car, it just means that other people haven't realized yet. Every single car on the planet has an engine of some sort. Now I know that Teslas and other electric cars have batteries, but the traditional way is an internal combustion engine. Every engine has thousands of parts in it that are required to make it work and to produce the power to get the car to move. Now one of the most important parts of any car is oil. And what you have here is the oil I use. This is not cash for comments, this is genuinely what I use. And the reason I use it is because in my experience, it's the best oil. And the best oil in this car is a good thing. The oil circulates in the engine and it lubricates it so that the engine basically doesn't fuse together. And as you can imagine, that's an important thing. Over here, we have the oil filter. The oil filter basically takes any contaminants that may have come into the engine, including bits of engine, bits of metal that might be floating around, and it filters it out in the oil filter. The idea is that everything is as clean as it possibly can be. In this box is the air filter, and the air filter is all about taking the air that's required to make the engine work and taking out all the bits that are not needed to go into the cylinders. And speaking of cylinders, we have these things called spark plugs. Now these are the plugs that I use, and this is actually a brand new plug. I'm just going to take it out and show it to you. Here we have an iridium plug. And as you can see, there's an iridium tip here. And that iridium causes a very clean, powerful spark to go through. So when the engine is working, it works like this: suck, squeeze, bang, blow. So it sucks the fuel in, it squeezes it down, it ignites the fuel, and then it blows out the exhaust. And that spark plug is absolutely essential for this to work. Now, when we consider how an engine works, it's very similar to a body. A body requires lubricant. The best lubricant we have in our body is water. We are 70% water. It's so important to drink water and to drink enough of it. If we don't have water in our system, then things can start to go wrong very, very quickly. And a lot of people don't realize just by drinking water, you can stay a whole lot healthier. It flushes your system out and it keeps your body working. When we're looking at the spark plug, the spark plug in our body is actually, some people say it's the heart, but it's not the heart. It is actually calcium. Calcium in our body, most people know it's required for bones and bone density to keep your bones strong. However, calcium is also the element that causes the heart to beat. It's the electrical charge that causes the heart to beat. So our spark plug is taking in the right nutrients. We've covered water, now we have to take in the appropriate nutrients, which include calcium in our body. When we look at the filters, now we've got two of them on the car. We've got the air filter and we've got the oil filter. Filters are super important because filters affect everything in our body. We have the filters about what we watch. Am I watching things that can be detrimental to my life? They might be fun, but they could put bad information into my life. We have to be very careful what we watch on TV. We need to be very careful what we read. We need to be very careful about the people we associate with. Then we have the air filter. Now, air we haven't covered in any great detail yet, but air has oxygen in it. Oxygen goes around our body and it actually carries the nutrients required, and it causes helps the blood flow, and the oxygen goes to every single part of our body. In the car, if there's no oxygen, there is no combustion. There is no explosion that takes place within the cylinder. If we don't have the right air, if we don't have the right nutrients going in, including how we charge the atmosphere, are you around negative people? You know the kind I mean? I'm talking the Eeyores. All right, if I have to. How are you today? Well, you know, everything is just great. And you know that these people are trying sometimes to be happy. Sometimes they're just negative people. Air around us has a charge. Now, you can charge it positively or you can charge it negatively. And when we're looking at our sphere of friends, it's so important to have good friends around us. So the air filter helps us do that. Now, if we get all these ingredients right, then the engine can fire nice and cleanly. Now, I'm just going to go and start the engine, and then I'm going to rev the engine so you folks can hear this engine rev. Fuel into our body, we have the right filters in place, and right circle of friends around us. Thanks for listening. Thank you.
truth when I can't find it. Light up this broken heart and light my way through my time on earth is done.
Edwin Thomas was a master of the stage. During the latter half of the 1800s, this small man with a huge voice had few rivals. Debuting in Richard III at the age of 15, he quickly established himself as a premier Shakespearean actor. In New York, he performed Hamlet for 100 consecutive nights. In London, he won the approval of the tough British critics. And when it came to tragedy on the stage, Edwin Thomas was in a select group. Edwin had two brothers, John and Junius. Both were actors, although neither of them became as famous as Edwin on stage. In 1863, the three brothers united their talents to perform Julius Caesar. The fact that Edwin's brother John took the role of Brutus was a weird omen of what awaited the brothers, the nation, 2 years from then. For it was John who played the assassin in Julius Caesar and then decided to do the same in real life. On a crisp April night in 1865, John strolled into the quietly strolled into the rear of a box in the Washington Theatre and fired a bullet at the head of Abraham Lincoln, the then President of the United States of America. Yes, the last name of the brothers was Booth, Edwin Thomas Booth and John Wilkes Booth. Edwin was never the same after that night. Shame from his brother's crime drove him into early retirement. Nobody wanted to hire him or give him any work. He might never have returned to the stage had it not been for a twist of fate at a New Jersey train station. Edwin was quietly waiting for his train to arrive when a well-dressed young man, pressed by the crowd, lost his footing and fell between the platform of the moving train. Without hesitation, Edwin locked a leg around a railing, grabbed the man and pulled him to safety. After the sighs of relief, the young man recognized the famous Edwin Booth. Edwin, on the other hand, didn't recognize the young man he'd rescued. That knowledge came weeks later in a letter he carried in his pocket for the rest of his life. A letter from General Adams Boudow, Chief Secretary to the famous General Ulysses S. Grant. The letter was thanking Edwin Booth for saving the life of the child of an American hero, Abraham Lincoln. How ironic that while one brother killed the president, the other brother saved the president's son. That boy was Edwin Thomas, yanked. The boy that Edwin Thomas yanked to safety was Robert Todd Lincoln. In looking at Edwin and John Booth, they had the same father, mother, profession and passion, yet one chooses life, the other chooses death. How could it be? I don't know, but it works out like that. Their story is dramatic, but it's not unique. In the Bible, we have Abel and Cain, both sons of Adam. Abel chooses God, Cain chooses murder, and God lets him. Abraham and Lot, both pilgrims in Canaan. Abraham chooses God, Lot chooses Sodom, and God lets him. David and Saul, both kings of Israel. David chooses God, Saul chooses power, and God lets him. Peter and Judas, both deny their Lord. Peter seeks mercy, Judas seeks death, and God lets him. In every age of history, on every page of Scripture, the truth is revealed. God allows us to make our own choices. In the Old Testament, God spoke to his children and offered them the choice of life or death. Come with me to Deuteronomy 30, 11 to 20. It reads like this. Now, what I am commanding to you today is not too difficult for you or beyond your reach. It is not up in heaven, so that you have to ask who will ascend into heaven to get it and proclaim it to us so that we may obey. Nor is it beyond the sea, so that you have to ask who will cross the sea to get it and proclaim it to us so that we may obey it. No, the word of God is very near to you. It is in your mouth and it is in your heart, so you may obey it. See, I set you before today life and prosperity, death and destruction. For I command you today to love the Lord your God, to walk in his ways, and to keep his commands, decrees and laws. Then you will live and increase, and the Lord your God will bless you in the land you are entering to possess. But if your heart turns away and you are not obedient, and if you are drawn away to bow down to other gods and worship them, but I declare to you this day that you will be certainly destroyed. You will not live long in the land you are crossing the Jordan to enter and possess. Today I call heaven and earth as witnesses against you, that I have set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Now choose life, so that you and your children may live, and that you may love the Lord your God, listen to his voice, and hold fast to him. For the Lord is your life, and he will give you many years in the land he swore to give to your fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. So God here in these verses is giving his children the ability to choose life or death, blessings or curses. And he encourages them to choose life. Later on in time, God still allowed his people, his children, to make choices. And no one sets this out more clearly than Jesus. And according to him, we can choose a narrow gate or the wide gate, a narrow road or a wide road, a big crowd or a small crowd. And we can choose to build on rock or on sand, serve God or riches, be numbered among the sheep or the goats. God gives us the ability to make choices, but remember, our choices have eternal consequences. A psychologist that I like once said, "You choose the behavior, you choose the consequences." Isn't this a reminder of Calvary's trio? Have you ever wondered why there were two crosses next to Christ, one on each side? Why not five or six? Did you ever wonder why Jesus was in the center? Why not on the left or the right? Could it be that the two crosses on the hill symbolize one of God's greatest gifts, the gift of choice? Two criminals have so much in common, convicted by the same system, condemned by the same death, surrounded by the same crowd, equally close to the same Jesus. In fact, they begin with the same sarcasm. Matthew 27:44 says, "In the same way, the robbers who were crucified with him also heaped insults on him." When we go to Luke 23:39-43, it says this: "One of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him. 'Aren't you the same? Aren't you the Christ? Save yourself and us.' But the other criminal rebuked him. 'Don't you fear God?' he said, 'since you are under the same sentence. We are punished justly, for we are getting what our deeds deserve. But this man has done nothing wrong.' Then he said, 'Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom.' And Jesus answered him with these beautiful words, 'I tell you the truth, today you will be with me in paradise.'" Much has been said about the prayer of the repentant thief, and it certainly warrants our admiration. But while we rejoice at the thief who changed, should we also be forgetting about the one who didn't? What about him, Jesus? Wouldn't a personal invitation be appropriate? Wouldn't a word of persuasion be timely? Does not the shepherd leave the 99 sheep and pursue the lost one? Does not the housewife sweep the house until the lost coin is found? Yes, the shepherd does, the housewife does. But the father of the prodigal son, remember, he does nothing. The sheep was lost innocently, the coin was lost irresponsibly. But the prodigal son left intentionally. The father gave him a choice. Jesus gave both criminals the same. You know, when it comes to choices, there are times when God sends thunder to stir us. There are times when God sends blessings to lure us. There are times when God sends nothing but silence as he honors us with the freedom to choose where we spend eternity. And what an honor it is. In so many areas of life, we have no choice. Think about it. You didn't choose your gender at birth, your parents, your siblings, your place of birth, your skin color, the size of your nose, how short or tall you are. Sometimes the lack of choices angers us and we say, "It's not fair. It's not fair that I was born in poverty or that I sing so poorly or that I run so slowly." But God chose to be fair even before the Garden of Eden. Even after Adam and Eve failed God and let him down, God still gave man free will. Ellen White says this: "Without freedom of choice, his obedience wouldn't have been voluntary, but forced. There could have been no development of character. Such a course would have been contrary to God's plan." And then she says this: Any injustice in this life is offset by the honor of choosing our destiny in the next. In the next life, there's honor, rewards, there's eternal joy for the right choices we make today. Some say it would be nice if God let us order life like we order a meal. I'll take good health and a high IQ. I'll take a six-pack and muscles. I'll pass on the music skills, but give me a fast metabolism. Wouldn't it be nice if life was like that? But it's not how life works. When it came to your life on earth, you weren't given a choice or a vote. But when it comes to your life after death, you are given a choice. To me, that sounds like a good deal. Wouldn't you agree? Have we been given any greater privilege than that of choice? I don't think about it. Think about the thief who repented. Though we know little about him, we know this. He made some bad mistakes in life. He chose the wrong crowd, the wrong morals, and the worst behavior. I gather you've made some wrong choices in life. I certainly have. Maybe you've chosen the wrong friends, maybe the wrong career, maybe the wrong lifestyle, maybe the wrong life partner. You might even look back on your life and say, if only I could make up for the bad choices. You can. You can choose eternity now. Mark Finley says this, and he's the great Adventist evangelist. God never compels the obedience of man. He leaves all free to choose whom they will serve. How can two brothers be born of the same mother, grow up in the same home, and one chooses life and the other chooses death? I don't know, but they did. And when one prayed, Jesus loved him enough to save him. And when the other mocked, Jesus loved him enough to let him. He allowed him choice. He does the same for you. He does the same for you. What choices are you making in reference to your work life? That's not the most important question in life. What choices are you making in reference to your family life? We're getting a bit deeper now. What choices are you making in reference to your church life? We're getting even deeper. What choices are you making today that have eternal value? What choices are you making to serve Jesus Christ in 2021? It's January 23. The year has started, and before we know it, it's going to be the end of the month. We start church here in February, and the year rolls on. What choices are you making to serve God this year? I'm going to pray next, but before I do, we're going to finish. I want to say a few things, but after the prayer, we're going to finish with a song titled We Are the Reason by David Phelps. I love that song. It's been around for a long time. We are the reason that he, Jesus, gave his life. We are the reason that he suffered and died. To a world that was lost, he gave all he could give to show us the reason to live. My reason to live is to honor and serve Jesus with my life. I hope and pray that that becomes your reason for living today. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for calling us to prayer. You asked us to pray when life gets hard, when we're persecuted, when we're joyful. You've asked us to be patient in affliction and faithful with our prayer life, and to pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. You've asked us not to be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present our request to you, God. You asked us to devote ourselves to prayer, being watchful and thankful. You've asked us to pray continuously. May our prayer today be an act of obedience. Please respond to our needs, to our hearts. Please show yourself in powerful ways and love us through our journey through life. Thank you that we are the reason that you gave your life. In Jesus' name we ask and pray these things. Amen.
you do.